Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Duck Boat Report, your home for the biggest news.
That's wild.
It's crazy.
And the hottest takes.
I don't know if that made any sense.
In all of Boston sports. We'll talk Pats, Sox, Bruins, Celtics, and so much more.
I think we hit it all.
Kicking on the tough subjects.
You can't stay on the field if you suck.
With plenty of laughs along the way.
We have lost it.
Now let's introduce you to our big three.
They have the skills.
Brady Gardner.
I just kind of ruined my own point, didn't I?
Patrick Donnelly.
We're talking about like he's the second coming of Jesus Christ.
And Ethan Fuller.
He's a legend.
How's it going, everyone? Welcome to episode 57 of the Duck Boat Report, another special edition episode doing an all-time draft of the Boston Red Sox. I'm Brady Gardner here with Patrick Donnelly and Ethan Fuller. How we doing, guys?
Doing all right.
Better than last episode?
I suppose.
That's what we're always training for. We're looking for an upward trend here.
I mean, I'm still technically employed, but also unemployed at the same time. And really just have absolutely nothing to do. I've been kicking myself every day. I should have taken a summer class, or at least summer one term. I don't really want to do summer two term because it's late in the summer. You're trying to make the most of your time. I'm going to cut it there. I'm just having an existential crisis right now.
Thank you, Patrick. Well, we, like you said, we're, you know, finding ways to spend our time. And as you people know, we started this all-time draft series. It was almost a month ago at this point. And we're coming back to it for the
Red Sox. Made the people wait for it.
Yes, I'm making people wait. The Red Sox today, and hopefully the Patriots sometime in the near future, we shall see. How are we feeling about our Red Sox draft, fellas? We were just talking about it a little bit off the air, but let's hear it here on the official record.
I'm feeling,
not
I'm feeling poor.
Bob, not great, Bob.
No? You don't know your Red Sox history?
No.
One of the most iconic franchises in global sports?
Not nearly as well as I know the Boston Celtics or the Boston Bruins.
I feel about this. I'm confident. I think I should do pretty well here.
I mean, you're far and away the Red Sox guy in this podcast.
Right. So I'm hoping for big
things. You work
things.
At freaking Fenway Park.
Back.
Worked.
I do. Worked. Supposed
worked.
To. I will
supposed
next
to
season.
Have worked.
I'll be there, I hope. So, yeah, let's see how this goes. Let's break out the random number generator to figure out how we're drafting. I'm not going to do myself first because that got sketchy last time. I don't know. Who wants to go first? Who's the first number?
I think Ethan's the only one who hasn't gone first yet.
All right, Ethan.
I'll go first.
Generate. Third.
Oh, classic.
Patrick's next. Whoa. First. That means I am second. Alrighty, fellas.
All right. Man. Well, at least you got an easy pick.
Do I?
Does he?
I think you do.
I don't think I do.
I think
I have the most pressure out of everyone here.
Yeah, I have an easy pick because there's two.
There's two.
That's what I think.
But dude, I'm about to pick somebody. I'm gonna get murdered for my pick.
Just you know the safe pick.
By the way, everybody, we're doing.
But I don't want to pick him.
We're doing 9 position players. We're doing 2 starting pitchers, 1 reliever, a head coach, should have said that, or manager, I guess it's called in baseball, and to close it out, a bench player / cult hero, as we have done with every one of these all-time drafts.
Is there a DH for the lineup?
Oh, yes. So 10 players, 10 roster players.
Got
alrighty.
It.
Patrick, the number one selection, what are we looking at?
Man, everyone's going to say Ted Williams, but I don't know if I want to pick him just because I don't know. All right, I'm going to bite the bullet and go Ted Williams. I mean, you can't – it's the safe one, but
we're not a clickbait podcast, yeah.
I mean, oh, man. I'm not going to say who I really wanted to pick and hope I can get him.
Well, I think – I mean, you'd be silly not to take the guy that I'm about to take here. And we didn't give you a ton of time to rationalize the Ted Williams decision, but I think it's pretty obvious the splendid splinter and his just crazy career in Boston.
So he's outfield, correct?
Left field, yes.
All right. Well, I'm just going to do 3 outfielders. I'm not going to go left, center, right.
Ooh, interesting. I'm going to do my best to go left, center, and right. We'll see how it goes. But yeah, Ted Williams going first. It's a good pick from Patrick. I would have definitely scooped him up if he was here at 2, but instead I'm going to go – with David Ortiz.
You see, he wasn't on my radar that much.
He wasn't?
He was on my radar.
You got to slot him in at DH.
He was on my radar for two. Like,
okay,
I was either getting him if he was the second pick, I was obviously going to take him. But first, I don't know if I would have taken him.
You know? Well, I'm thinking of it more not for the positional aspect, but more of having a guy that's just heart of the order, and you just know any situation, this guy is going to produce an unreal career here in Boston. And thankfully, we were able to kind of grow up with him, you know, being the heart of the Red Sox. Which I think a lot of these players that we might end up with, as has been the case in previous drafts, like we have barely ever heard of. This is definitely a guy that we know and love from our lifetimes, and a guy who one of the most clutch hitters in baseball history. Great guy for the city of Boston. David Ortiz is in the team. Ethan.
Yeah. I mean, who doesn't love Ortiz? Who doesn't love Big Poppy? Probably would have taken him because I guess I have back-to-back picks. But yeah. I'm going to take – we'll lead it off with Carl Yastrzemski because he seems like a safe and strong option.
Good pick.
Career 285 hitter, peaked in 67, that monster year he had. 44 home runs, 121 RBI, led the league in, like, every major hitting category that year. Won MVP that year, obviously. As far as career – I mean, he played 22 years for the Red Sox. So that's it. That's pretty crazy on its own. So we'll take Yaz. Next, I'm taking a pitcher. There's three obvious pitching choices.
Don't do it.
Don't do it.
And
I think I'm going to take the I'm going to go pure power here, and I'm going to take Roger Clemens.
Oh, my gosh. The Rocket. Okay. Yeah,
I think he's the best pitcher in Red Sox history. And
don't you, like, do it, Gardner.
You're
going to take Pedro?
I'm going to take Pedro. Sorry, before Patrick gets his hopes up. Pedro with this pick.
Get out of here. Leave the chat.
Roger Clemens being the first pitcher off the board, though, Ethan. I think it's a unique pick. But the guy was dominant. Like, you watch some of those highlights, like late 90s, early 2000s.
He absolutely.
Insane. Might have had a little help. Might have had a little bit of help.
I've always been pretty lenient on the steroid penalties for guys, so I don't have that much of a problem with it. If it gets you wins. So,
there you go.
I mean, strikeout rate almost 23%. That's unbelievable.
It's pretty nuts. I'm gonna go Pedro, as you heard. Just absolutely dominant here in Boston. I believe he was here from 98 through 2004. So he ended pretty much right there when they broke the drought. And was, you know, kind of that, I guess, era that kind of brought the Red Sox back into contention there. And he was absolutely filthy in those days. He had 23 wins in 1999. That's bolded and italicized on Baseball Reference, which makes me think it's quite important. Oh, it's because he led his league that year, led all the majors. 23 wins, that's nuts. Also, like, destroyed the National League in that All-Star game. That's like one of the most iconic All-Star game performances for those of you who care about that. I think it's a no-doubter. Pedro is my number one starter. Excited to have him in. Pedro and David Ortiz to start things off. Team's looking good.
I'm surprised that you're the one that's so far gone young for the Red Sox versus us two.
It's a good point. I mean, I don't know. We'll see. Late rounds is usually when I dig into the old guys. If you recall the Celtics draft, that's when we started going to the, you know, 50s and those eras. So, Patrick, your second pick, what are we looking at?
I'm not happy with you at all.
Ethan left him there hanging. I had to take him.
I was really hoping you'd take Curt Schilling.
What?
But what we're going to go here, we're going to go Manny Ramirez.
Ooh. I like it.
A nice little consolation prize for myself. Certainly the peak of his career. It was kind of like the back nine of his career, but the guy was still a 35 plus 40 home run guy, even like in the back half of his major league career, at least.
Mm-hmm.
And then wasn't much of note after the Red Sox, but he's still playing, so he's got the longevity. And they're still paying him.
He's still playing.
They should absolutely bring him back because they're going to suck either way. They're paying this guy $2.5 million. So I'm all for bring Manny Ramirez back to Boston as a 48-year-old. And then next pick, cause we got two in a row. I'm not even going to go near Curt Schilling. I'm going to take John Lester as my ace.
Wow.
I like that.
Wow.
I take John Lester as my ace. 1,519 innings pitched for the Red Sox, 3.64 ERA. If I'm not mistaken, that is among the top three or top four for like notable Red Sox pitchers. You got Pedro, Lefty Groove, Chris, and Chris Sale ahead of him as far as aces go. But I think I like this John Lester pick.
I like that.
Also an element of what could have been had they not totally botched that situation.
Yeah. Should have been a career Red Sox, I think. But, yeah, I like the pick there, Patrick. John Lester, nicely done. I'm going to get a positional player here, but somebody who definitely has a good bat. And at a position I think that doesn't have a ton of depth comparatively here in the all-time list, it's going to be Jimmy Fox at first base. This was a guy that played pretty early on, let's say, between the 20s and the 40s. So we're getting into some older guys here, but spent plenty of time with the Red Sox and had some very productive productive years. I'm just reading down his statistics here. Batting average tended around the 300s, even put up 349 and 360 in back-to-back seasons, which is unheard of these days, I feel like. I mean, that's a different kind of game these days for sure. He was MVP 3 years in a row, actually. And with Philadelphia Athletics, he won it 5 years in a row. So just a great baseball player. Yeah, Jimmy Fox, first base for me.
I like it. I was thinking about him. I'm also going to go – I'm going to go with two position players right now, both at positions that I think are fairly scarce. We'll scoop up – just making sure I didn't miss anyone super important here. We'll scoop up Wade Boggs to at the hot corner.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a strong pick. He played 10 years for the Red Sox. Let me grab some stats to talk about. Had some fantastic seasons, most notably, I mean, he was hurt a lot, which is too bad, but had a strong 24 home run, 89 season. Great hitter. He batted, wow, this is actually crazy. In his 10 years with the Red Sox, he batted over 300 in 9 of those years, including at least 6 years where he batted over 330. So that's pretty unbelievable in the late 80s. So we'll get Wade Boggs there.
I like it.
And then we'll go to another position player at a position that I think your guys are going to find a lot harder. And for his leadership, winning player, you know who it's going to be, Dustin Pedroia. Let's go.
Oh.
I think that's a fantastic choice. Not a lot of second baseman all time on the Red Sox. So I think Pedroia is going to be great. Injuries basically took him out a lot, but fantastic second baseman, really solid hitter. I think that's such a consistent guy that I can have. Put him at two in the order. Perfect.
I like that. Strong defense there too. I think we're going to be looking at a lot of offensive numbers here, but you're getting good defense from Pedroia. So that's a nice pick there. I'm going to go behind the dish with Carlton Fisk, a guy who had quick math, 24-year career in the majors. Spent about half of it with the Sox, half of it with the White Sox over in Chicago. But that first half with the Red Sox, pretty impressive numbers. Quite a list of MVPs. Had 7 All-Stars as a Red Sox. And just, you know, consistent numbers on offense. And especially one thing I liked about him, just like a total grit player from like the videos you see, like totally different era of baseball when, you know, you'd see like catchers getting mowed over by runners. And he was always just a guy that threw himself at these runners coming in at him, at full speed. And of course the iconic, you know, waving the ball fair. And was it like game 6 of the World Series?
Game 6. Yep.
Yep. What year was that? That was,
I don't even know.
76, I think was, oh gosh. The impossible dream year. Or is it 67? He wasn't on the team in 67. What am I thinking?
I don't know, man. Everyone knows what you're talking about. You don't need the year.
Yeah.
Carl, 75 World Series. Okay. Game 6. Iconic. Iconic. We're looking for icons here, and we got it. We got some clutch postseason hitting, too. I like it. Carlton.
Okay. So we got two picks in a row. It doesn't really matter here. We're going to go to both corners of the infield. First up, third base, we're going to get Mike Lowell.
I knew you were going to take him.
Big Mike Lowell guy. I mean, 21 home runs, 17 home runs, 17 home runs from age 32 to 35 at the Red Sox. And then even in basically playing half the games, he still managed to put up like five as a 36-year-old, which isn't much to sniff at. But, I mean, guy was still pretty old, getting it done in a bench role. And when he was a starter, he was still elite. And then you talk about like a heart and soul guy in the locker room and stuff, just one of those veteran leaders.
I was on a plane with Mike Lowell one time.
What?
Really?
By pure chance, we were flying.
Oh, I thought you would have coordinated with him. I wasn't sure.
No, not this time.
Is Mike Lowell a tight?
Not yet. I should have. No, that's the thing. I was a senior in high school coming back from a April vacation trip. We had a connecting flight in Miami. And Michael was just on the plane in first class. He is sound asleep. And I did not think it was a good idea to wake him up. So I did not talk to him.
Smart move there.
I'm sure he would have been a great guy, though.
Okay. All righty. Patrick, you have another pick here. Fifth round.
Yep, fifth round. We're going to go first base. I don't think he's been taken yet. I think only one first baseman's been taken. We're going to go Mo Vaughn.
Ooh.
Okay.
I mean, if we're talking about power, at his peak – I mean, consistent 20 home runs, and then it was just a slow progression. Single digits, teens, and then he moves up into the 20s, then high 30s. We got a couple 40 years and then a lot more 30 years. So he's certainly got the offensive firepower, and I honestly don't know a whole ton about his defense. But It really doesn't matter. I mean, it's first base. Just catch the throws coming in. Those are my two picks.
Your team scares me on offense. Williams, Manny Ramirez, Mo Vaughn, even Mike Lowell, like a hitter.
Even you Mike Lowell.
Respect.
Yep.
But Mike Lowell's the worst hitter of that group. That's saying something.
And Mike Lowell, like until he was old and decrepit in that final year, was a consistent 20 home run guy.
Wow. I guess I kind of forgot about that.
But that was all with the Florida Marlins. He had four World Series.
That 07 season, if you look at that single season, it was loaded.
Yeah.
21 home run, 120 RBI. Batted 324 that year. Wow.
Yeah.
All righty.
Three World Series, I was mistaken.
Well, I'm going to stay around the Lowell and Vaughn years for my next pick, and a guy I can't believe has stuck around this long, shortstop Nomar Garcia.
Man.
This is a – he was a kind of a weird time as a Red Sox. You know, he was a fan favorite for years, drafted – I don't know when he was drafted, but he came in 1996, won the 97 Rookie of the Year award. He only played 24 games in 96, so still eligible for that Rookie of the Year, and he won it 97 and was, like, star of the team, just kind of carried them through some of those years, or at least, you know, kind of a leader on the field at the captain position there, kind of, a, as they say, with shortstop. And then you get to 2004 – and sacrificial lamb a little bit, you gotta say. Like this,
they DeMar DeRozan'd him.
Unfortunate, he had to get traded that year to make way for the championship that would come. So he didn't get it. I wonder if he got a ring. Actually, he didn't win the championship with the Sox, but he was a major part of building them up towards that. So I'm adding Noma as my shortstop.
It's a good pick.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree. That was a great pick. I'm struggling trying. I look at other quality shortstops right now.
Orlando Cabrera.
Let's see. Yeah, but
don't take Orlando Cabrera.
I'm not going to take Orlando Cabrera.
Cody Ross, baby.
No.
No, was he left field?
Julio Lugo.
Cody Ross. Wasn't he here for like 2 years?
Just
Julio,
I think, one.
Julio Lugo wasn't bad. Don't anyway, take Julio Lugo in round six, though, please.
I'm not going to take Julio Lugo in round six.
How about Jed Lowry?
I love Jed Lowry, actually. He had a fantastic year like 2 years ago on the A's. He was crazy. I think I picked him up off free agency.
Him and Josh Reddick are like two of those Red Sox guys from the early 2010s that just popped off.
Yeah. Lowry in 2018 had 23 home runs, 99 RBI. Like, you know, he had a crazy year. But that's not who I'm gonna pick. I'm going to pick the second best pitcher in Red Sox history. Somehow still on the board. Also, the oldest player any of us are going to pick. He literally has an award named after him, so I will take Cy Young.
Yep.
Career ERA of 2. That's pretty crazy. And we can play the comparing errors game, but I feel like the fact that you have an award named after you and you have a career ERA of 2 speaks for itself. That was the original prime Red Sox in like the 1901 to 1910 years. So I'll take Cy Young.
Yeah, I like that. That's digging way back in the record books, but that's a good pick.
And then another pick, I don't really know where I want to go. Here, I think we're going to take some pure power because I feel like I'm missing a little bit of pure power.
You are.
Although, I mean, Yaz is solid, but I'm going to take, I believe he's fourth all-time in career home runs for the Red Sox. I'll take Jim Rice. 382 home runs for the Red Sox. Had his number retired fairly recently, like within the last 10 years, I think. Monster year in like 1978. Has 46 home runs, almost 140 RBI. Just some of these years where he just absolutely went off. And right now he's an outfielder, I guess. He'll probably end up being my DH, but Jim Rice.
Interesting. You just kind of tipped your hand there. You told us your plan.
What?
I wasn't listening.
It's okay. Yeah, I guess there aren't many, you know, real notable DHs aside from Ortiz, so maybe that's not that special.
I mean, there's so many
outfielders too that I don't need to like.
Yeah. There's a guy I know like I need to have. Like, no doubt about it. I need that guy, but I don't know when I should draft him.
I'm gonna hold off tentatively.
I'm keeping an eye on the positions that you people are picking, too.
I also have one guy I need to have.
Oh, I really don't like
this. I think we might have similar people.
Oh, no, no, no. Okay. I feel like I almost want to go for a pitcher.
I feel like I might go for the guy I need to have just to get it out of the way.
I think you do, because I might take him next time. I might take him next time.
Well, no. I don't think he's, like, completely of note, but like the later we go, the higher the chance he gets picked.
You are making me nervous. The pitching list really isn't mind-boggling at the moment, so I think I can wait on pitchers. So I think I should just do it and take center fielder Johnny Damon. Is that the guy you're thinking of?
No.
That's not the guy I was thinking of.
That's the guy I was thinking of.
I'm gonna wait here.
You didn't let me rationalize Johnny Damon.
Okay, I
actually would like to hear this because I haven't seen him on the top of any public Red Sox boards. So I'm interested.
He was the first pick in Pete Blackburn's draft.
Right.
Really?
This is kind of, you know, looking at my lineup and looking at kind of a position of need in both the order and on the diamond, right? I don't have any outfielders yet. This is a guy who's more than capable defensively. But then, of course, you slot him right in to the top of the order, no problem. And he was only with the Red Sox for 4 years, which felt a whole lot longer than that, I must admit. But he was, you know, sick in those years, brought them a championship in 04, had some money issues, which sent him to the Yankees, but we don't talk about that as Red Sox fans. And overall, just kind of one of the major pieces of the puzzle there in that 04 team that's just, you know, so legendary in Red Sox history, which is why I keep taking so many players from those years. So I'm going to take Johnny Damon. Maybe a little premature. Yes, I know. But I had to bring him in to play center field.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm going to hold off on the guy I have to have because I have a good feeling. I don't know how high on your radars he is. So we're going to round out our outfield here. So far, I think I'll put Ted Williams in left. I think I'll do Manny in center. Or no, Manny. I'll do Manny. Well, all right. So I guess we'll hold off on my exact lineup for now.
Yeah.
But we're going to round out at least having three outfielders. And we're going to go Mookie Betts.
Dang it. No, that was my guy. That was
Let's
guy.
Go.
I would trade many picks.
The trajectory he had as a Red Sox, like, he just burst on the scene as, like, a September call-up And then his first full season, he puts up 18 home runs in a very solid year. And then it's just from there, sky's limit, 26 – or no, I'm looking at the wrong column. 31 home runs, 24, 32, 29. And the MVP, the World Series, obviously. And another one like kind of John Lester where they just totally bungled that situation and he should still be wearing a Red Sox uniform and probably should be for a very long time. But it is what it is. Ethan's not happy about it all over again. And then another – I mean, we don't have a ton of infielders yet. We just have the corners. So we're going to kind of go middle of the infield here. We're going to take Xander Bogaerts at shortstop.
Wow.
Oh, wait, I don't have a shortstop. I didn't even think about him.
Xander Bogaerts at shortstop. I'm surprised he lasted this long just given the shortstop situation.
Yeah.
And, it speaks for himself. He's like – I mean, even last year when Mookie was still on the team, he kind of just took over and ran the show. You could see he was going to be a star in 2013 when he was coming off the bench in the World Series and playing third base. Obviously he's got the defense, the mainly a contact hitter, but the power has been popping up the last few seasons. So I'm excited to see what he can do down the road.
Yeah. I didn't even think about him when I went with Nomar because maybe I could have, I don't know. I like the Nomar pick still, but
Nomar, I would still take Nomar ahead of Bogaerts.
Oh yeah.
Just body work.
I feel like end of their careers. If we look back on this and 15 years, there's a chance that Bogaerts could be, better than Garcia Parra.
Well,
I think he will be.
Been a Red Sox longer than Nomar was already.
Already? Yeah, because he was 2013.
2013 yeah. to 2020.
Interesting.
And Nomar was, 98 to 04? So the same amount of years.
Maybe 96, but yeah.
Nomar's got him by 2 years then.
He's going to outlast him. He just signed a new contract. So.
Yeah.
Interesting stuff. Again, I'm contemplating going for a pitcher, but again, I think I'm going to hold off because I'm thinking we're going to go for the outfield again, and I'm going to pick a right fielder here by the name of Dwight Evans. 2,500 games in a Red Sox uniform, which is pretty wild. He's number four on the team in hits, number three on the team in runs, just a guy, a lot of production and played, right field for that long with the Red Sox, it means that you're doing something, right? One of the most difficult parts of any major league ballpark to play. And he patrolled it for quite some time. Career average of .272 isn't that encouraging. So might be a little bit lower in the lineup, but can't complain. Dwight Evans, pretty well-rounded player. I'll bring him in for right field.
I like it. I'm still kind of spiraling because I wanted Mookie so bad.
All right, I'm really going to be sweating out these next three picks.
I'm furious.
Do you have three guys that you want?
I have one guy I absolutely have to have, and I have one guy I really want, but if I don't get him, it's not at the end of the world.
I think I know one of those guys. I probably am not going to take him yet, so you can take him. The guy I'm going to take first – because one of my strategies has been taking I'm just going to take Red Sox players that have won MVP. I didn't realize that Mo Vaughn won the MVP in 95, first of all. So that was it. Adds to that being a great pick. I'm going to take Fred Lynn. Four-time Gold Glove winner, won Rookie of the Year, won MVP in 75. Did a lot of great stuff early in his career and then kind of faded away later in his career. But when he was young and in his prime, in his late 20s, He was a force. Again, injuries kind of had their way with him, but great fielder. I'll stick him in my outfield. So we have two fantastic outfielders now with Yaz and Fred Lynn.
Yeah. Fred Lynn's still a good guy, by the way. He's around Fenway all the time. Like how they do the legend suite.
Yeah, he's always there.
He's always there. He must live.
He's one of the guys. That's great.
He's always the guy.
Sometimes they I think they literally pull Jim Rice from the broadcast booth. They're like, okay, we don't have anybody playing. Jim, just walk over there for a second, would you?
Guys, Fred's not here tonight.
Yeah, Fred has season tickets in the Legends booth. Like, he's always there. So, good pick there, Ethan. Nicely done.
Thank you. Now, because none of us have taken a reliever yet, I think this has been – so, I've been looking at the different relief closer options, and there's – there's no one that I'm whoa. And it's definitely going to be someone modern. I'm looking at Kimbrell, Koji Uehara, but I think I am going to take the guy that probably is most memorable for a lot of people just because of the way they won the World Series. I definitely will take in my next pick, Jonathan Papelbon. So we will lock him up. Most saves in Red Sox history, 219 saves. Four-time All-Star with the Red Sox. And I know he was kind of not a great teammate, especially when he left the Red Sox, but I really liked him when he was here. So I'll take Papelbon.
Yeah. Dang. He was on my list, but I thought I could wait a little longer. I wasn't sure when we were going to get to relief pitchers. So you're a couple picks ahead of when I expected.
It's 2-1, right?
Yeah, 2 starters, 1 reliever.
Huh. I think I have the 2 best starters and the best reliever in Red Sox history. So.
Yeah. Okay. I'm looking at other relief options right now. I'm not a huge fan. Gotta admit, I don't want to really go with Koji. He was here for 2 seasons, and it was a magical, I think it was 2 seasons. He had a magical run in Boston, but I don't know if it was really long enough. I may have to do some research on some of these other names, I gotta admit. So maybe I will hold off on that, because something tells me Patrick's knowledge of Red Sox relief pitchers might be a little limited as well.
Well, I mean, I could kind of toe the line of what relief is.
Chris Sale.
No, yeah. Like,
got the save in the World Series.
I mean, I'm not considering Chris Sale for something like that, but for playoff guys who were huge in playoff relief and were starters during the regular season and were kind of just like off-rotation starters during the playoffs and did the brunt of their work in the bullpen, I've been considering that. But that'd be a lot to put onto the graphic.
We'll
so
see.
Maybe I should just play it traditional, but go on with your pick.
Yes, my pick, and this is another guy that maybe has slipped a little bit, but I'm looking at positions that kind of overlap with one of you guys and where I want to get a guy here, and it's going to be second base because I know Patrick is still looking for one, and it's the hits leader for all second basemen in Red Sox history, Bobby Doerr, number 4, I think.
Good pick.
Bobby Doerr. that would be great. I hope he's number 4. I don't think he was. Can I get a picture with his number, please? Oh, he wore number 1. Dang it. They retired number 4. I don't know who it is. Regardless, Bobby Doerr, more than 1,000 runs, more than 2,000 hits, more than 1,200 RBIs, and an overall career average of .288. Strong defensively. Easy pick there for second base.
Okay. So I'm very happy my guy is still here.
He is.
But I'm not gonna pick him first. We're gonna round out the starting pitching here with this pick. I'm kind of shocked he's still on the board. But we're gonna go Josh Beckett. It didn't end well with the whole. He was part of the whole chicken and beer in the dugout, I believe.
Yep.
He was in that Dodgers trade. But I mean, like, to burst onto the scene and just be a bona fide ace from day one with the Marlins. And then not only like do that for 5 seasons and be able to continue to do that for 6 more seasons with the Red Sox. And I mean, Tony Mazz has been saying it a lot. I know he said it recently. I think he said it several times. But like Josh Beckett's 2007 postseason might be the greatest postseason in Red Sox history. Just flat out dominance from day one with the Red Sox. 20 wins in 2007. In ERA of 3.27 in 2007, his lowest with the Red Sox. Oh, no, he had 2.89 in 2011, but we don't really talk about that year. I'm trying to find the postseason stats for 2011, but I remember seeing them just being blown away by how dominant he was. So that's my final starting pitcher. And then this guy, I don't know if I could have waited again because catcher is becoming a growing need for Ethan. But we're going to go with my guy, Jason Varitek. He's the guy I had to have on the squad. My favorite player growing up wanted to be a catcher until I realized I hated catching. Then we kind of moved on to Josh Beckett when I liked pitching. But nonetheless, I mean, he wore the, like, probably, wasn't he, is he not the last MLB wear the C on his jersey?
Last Red Sox player for sure.
I haven't seen an MLB player with the captain C, so like he has to be. But it goes to show you the leadership. When he was in his prime, he had the power, like high teens, 20 home run guy. and just kind of like a legend behind the plate for the modern Red Sox. Two World Series.
That's a good little battery you just put together right there, too. Josh Beckett, Jason Veritek, back-to-back.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. So you both have your starters, so I can wait a little bit on my second starter. But I might have to dig into the relief pitching in a second. But Ethan already has his, so I can wait another pick to get it.
I totally forgot about this guy. But, I mean, I'm pretty happy with Beckett.
There's another starter?
There's another starter that's kind of been a glaring omission.
Yeah, there's a very nice starter. Well, actually, two. I think there are two very good ones.
So I'll get the starter.
Yeah, two glaring omissions, I'd say.
I know the starter I'm going to draft.
Right, just say it. None of us are picking starters.
It'll be Curt Schilling in a second.
Really?
Wow, I would not. Wow.
Oh, Mutt.
I mean, Tim Wakefield's my top.
What about
glaring omission?
Tim Wakefield.
Tim Wakefield.
Second all-time in strikeouts, I think.
I mean, he's the only person, based on my research, to have 3,000-plus innings.
I don't know. I am very focused on the postseason, and when I think of Wakefield, I think of Aaron Boone slapping one into another planet off of him in 2003.
And then he vindicated himself.
He did? I don't know.
I mean,
he's
part of two World Series winning teams.
He was on the team. I don't remember him doing anything like that major, you know?
Let's see postseason pitching.
What about LT Hunt?
Louis Tiant, I mean, he's a fun guy to root for, but I don't know. He's cool to watch highlights of. But speaking of highlights, what I prioritize. I like the iconic moments.
I'm shocked you think you're going to take Dice K.
We got a cult hero in the bag.
Oh, cult hero in the bag.
Okay. All righty. I'm going to go with Curt Schilling. It's mostly because of the Bloody Sock game. but I think, you know, just a solid career in Boston. I had his stats up a second ago, and now I'm frantically trying to find them again so I can actually try to rationalize this decision. But he's going to be my second starter. Career ERA of 3.46, which is acceptable, maybe not elite, but it's fine. And then his years with the Sox, he finished his career here in Boston, actually, at the ripe ages of 37 through 40. So a long career for this fella. And arguably some of his best years at the end. So, I'll go with Curt Schilling for my second pitcher. Why not? Him and Pedro can go back-to-back like they did in 2004. It'll be great.
Okay.
That took a long time to make that pick.
No, that's helpful because I'm floundering right now. So the positions I need are catcher, shortstop, and I need another outfielder or two, right?
Yeah. You need one more outfielder, shortstop, first base.
Okay, so
wait a second. Oh, who are you DH-ing?
I'm going to DH Jim Rice.
Does that mean the Yastrzemski's in left?
Yep.
Okay. So, yes.
And then we got Fred Lynn in center. Okay, so I need a right fielder, first baseman, shortstop, catcher. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Man, so, yeah, this is kind of a tough spot because – shortstop and catcher had two in like a tier one and then no one else after that. So I'm going to hold off on them because you guys scooped up those two. I think for the final outfielder, just because I've seen him on so many all-time lineups, I know that if you look at his stats, he wasn't really that great, especially in the very old era of hitters. When home runs just didn't really happen. But he got a lot of RBI, a fantastic batting average, career 345 hitter. That's pretty crazy. So I will do a little bit of a nod to the old guys again and take Tris Speaker as my last player. I've seen him in a lot of all-time Red Sox starting lineups, so I feel like that means I gotta stick him in there somewhere. He was born in 1888, so we're really getting back there. Played in a lot of games. You know he's going to be healthy. You know he's going to get hits. And, I mean, you see the old videos of outfielders. They always look super fast. So, must be pretty fast.
Sure. Yeah. I think that's a good pick. And if you ask some old-timers, they would probably say he should have gone way earlier. But yeah, I like Tris Speaker there. Nicely done.
Yeah, I have a feeling my lineup's going to be popular with the old timers who may not necessarily be on Twitter. So,
Fred Lynn, click, Jim Rice, Cy Young,
or yeah, go to a SoundCloud link. So, we'll see how this works. But if I show my uncle, he'll love
Patrick,
it.
Are we still on SoundCloud?
Yeah, I haven't. I've been forgetting to post, but I will get them up.
I do YouTube. Patrick does SoundCloud. Ethan just brings that great personality.
Oh yeah,
man! Second base is such a black hole after the top two.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I kind of left you with that. Ethan, you have another pick here to kick off round 10.
I know. I'm working on it. Hang on one sec. Have you guys both taken first baseman? I feel like I should. I mean, I got to grab a first baseman because neither of you.
Do have a first baseman. I have Move On.
I have Jimmy neither, Fox.
Okay, so I guess none of you need the positions that I need. So I'm running a crazy rush here.
Holy cow, about a black hole. Left field.
I was thinking about Uke, but I feel like that's too basic.
I mean, who else would you pick? Mike Napoli? That's too basic.
That's more basic than Uke. Like the Red Sox over the last 15 years, they've kind of had issues at first base. Like, you had Adrian Gonzalez for 1 year. That was about it.
Could have Travis Shaw. Just move him over to first.
Yep.
You can take your time because I'm scrambling for one of these.
Okay. we're looking at catchers now. After
who am I missing? There's got to be something.
Okay. This guy is listed on a lot of sites as the third best catcher of all time, and he was Roger Clemens' catcher, so that works well for me. I'll take Rich Gedman, who grew up in Worcester. Pretty cool. He is a two-time All-Star. He was the behind the plate when Clemens had the 20-strikeout game. Let's see. He's definitely not going to be a hitting catcher, but that's okay. I mean, that's not going to be the end of the world. Take a look at his stats. I mean, he had some strong years. He had 24 home runs 1 year. Really kind of fell off after that. But while Clemens was here, he was good. So we'll go with Rich Gedman.
Yeah, that's kind of weird. You don't hear much of this Rich Gedman fella, but by the way you describe him, seems decent.
You don't hear much about any other Red Sox catcher. So
I guess. Alrighty. So that's your 10th pick. Yes. So I'm back on the board here. I'm still in search of an elusive left fielder. And after doing a lot of Googling in the time that Ethan was just picking, I'm still not convinced. So that makes me a little nervous. We're also still looking for a manager and a bench player. But
I forgot about the manager.
Are we doing a bench player and a cult hero?
Yes. Oh. Okay.
I think we should.
Someone that's actually helpful. Wait,
somebody can a bench player? Helpful?
I mean, because Ethan's picking the pitcher as his cult hero, and I know who I'm picking as my cult hero, and I do not want him off the bench.
Well, I'm not necessarily picking it. I mean, I am picking a pitcher as my cult hero, but you don't know what pitcher it's going to be.
Okay, we'll do a cult hero and a bench player. Good decision.
Can you pick a pitcher as your bench player or no?
No.
No.
Okay. Because I would take two pitchers, but... Oh wait, I know my bench.
Clay Buchholz, I know you.
I know my bench player.
You think I'd take Clay Buchholz?
I'm not taking Clay Buchholz, please.
Who do you say would take Clay Buchholz?
Oh, I know who I'm taking here though. Do I?
Let's just say I've got some tricks.
All right, TikTok.
Take Clay Buchholz, but you probably both would. I'm sorry, I got a pick here.
I've been the Clay Buchholz apologist here. Third base.
I'm going to third with a guy who kind of played both sides of the diamond, actually. And again, I'm sticking early 2000s here. I believe he was on the 07 team, but not the 04 team. I got to confirm that because I want to be right. This will be Kevin Youkilis. He was a Red Sox between the years of 04. So, yep. Through 2013. Oh, no. Mm-hmm. No. 2011, ended up a Yankee. Why do I keep getting some of those players?
In 2013, I mean, Yankee is in his final year. He went Red Sox, White Sox, Yankees.
Correct. Thank you. So he was with the Red Sox.
He went from first to third to DH. Right. On off.
You know this guy better than I do. But I remember Euclid mainly for the weird swing. And, you know, the joke, if you ever read Moneyball, is that he was the Greek god of walks because people just could not pitch to that swing when he was coming up through, like, the minors and everything. But as it turned out, when he actually swung, he was quite good at it. He had a career average of 382 career on base percentage, 281 career batting average, which is still solid, I suppose. He had 1,053 hits, so he's in the 1,000 club with the Sox. 9 years in Boston. Euclid will be playing third for my team.
Okay. So I'm going to DH Manny.
Okay. I like that decision. Get him out of the field.
And we're going to put Ted Williams in left.
Yep.
We're going to put Mookie in center. And we're going to go with a guy who I don't know. Like, I guess he – I don't know. The way kind of people talk about him, I guess he could kind of be a cult hero. But we're going with him in right field nonetheless. We're going Trot Nixon. just plenty of home runs. Ton of power in this lineup. 15 home runs, 12, 27, 24, 28. And then he had one pretty bad year in 04, his final year with the Red Sox. But he was part of that winning – or second to the last year with the Red Sox. But – nonetheless, got a ring, and from all accounts, solid in the field. I don't know where to find these fielding stats, but I don't know what any of them mean anyways, so I'd just be tossing out numbers.
nice.
So, yeah, Trot Nixon rounds out the outfield.
I knew who you were talking about the second you started saying, you know, kind of a cult hero. I don't know if you noticed, I had it typed into the Google.
No, I'm not looking. I kind of want to pick Jacoby Ellsbury, but he really, like, he was only good defensively until he had that one breakout year in, like, 2010 or
right.
2012, I think. Yeah. But other than that, he was mainly just a defensive – or known for his defense and speed. Trot Nixon seemed like he did it all around.
Okay. And then you have another pick?
Oh, yeah, we do. I didn't think that far ahead.
You're looking for a reliever.
Second base. I'm in no rush to take second base.
Right. Reliever, second base, manager, bench, cult hero.
I thought bench and cult hero.
Yeah, bench and right. Okay. When do you dig into a manager?
I'm not taking a manager for
three.
For like second to last. Reliever. I think that's what we're gonna go here. Okay. Another kind of legend just for the postseason. We're gonna go Keith Falk as the reliever. That iconic jump into Veritek's arm when they broke the curse. Mm-hmm. So I mean, that's just a duo made in heaven right there. My catcher and my reliever.
It is.
I'm trying to pull up his stats. Again, final 3 years with the Red Sox, but honestly, arguably like his most iconic years, or most, at least for us, his most iconic years. He wasn't that great after 04, but he still seemed serviceable. And then, I mean, when you break the curse and you throw the final out, something to be said. So, Keith Falk.
I like
wanted
it.
To go Koji, but. I really wanted to go Koji, but I don't think so.
Okay, so that opens up an opportunity for me to wait on a reliever. I'm also looking for a left fielder, but I think I know who I want, and there's no chance either of you take him. So I think I'm going to dig into the managers here. Would you believe it? I just got to confirm that this is the guy I want because it's easy to forget, you know, about other guys. You never know. Never do know. So, if it's, let's see.
Wow.
What?
I just found us. I think I just found a nice pick that I would like to make.
Alrighty. I'm going to go with the guy I was thinking of, and that's going to be Terry Francona. Yeah, I know I'm sticking with the theme of you know, the 04 guys and the, you know, 07, whatever. But Tito was here for 7 years. His first year was 2004. So people keep thinking, like, Alex Cora won a championship in his first year. Well, Tito did it before he did. So he had the 10th best win percentage as for any Red Sox manager. And I believe the longest tenure among anyone on that list. Yes, I just confirmed that. So he was here for a while. He won quite a bit. Terry Francona will be my manager.
Good pick.
Good pick. I'm going to take the all-time winningest manager in Red Sox history. Ooh. But I'm going to take him as a player because I realized that we had two glaring omissions at shortstop. Johnny Pesky, first of all, and Joe Cronin.
See, I considered Pesky for second base, but he didn't play enough of that. So,
yeah, that would have been an option too. But he's still going to be around. I'm not taking him.
Okay.
Joe Cronin is going to be my shortstop. Won over 1,000 games for the Red Sox. Yeah, he didn't win a World Series, but 1,000 games, 1,071 wins. Also was one of the better shortstops in Red Sox history. Had some great years with them, and considering that it's basically down to two players for shortstop, I will take Cronin as a player, and with that, take him out of the running for you guys for manager.
That's nice.
And I guess I get an assistant manager in that way. But I will also take first bases. There is nothing going on. I think I'm going to play the defense card here. The two options I was looking at were Adrian Gonzalez, which just seems like such a rough pick as my first baseman if we go all time. So I'm going to take George Scott, who is one of the best defensive first basemen ever. He won 8 gold gloves in his career. Only two of them were the Red Sox. But, like, crazy defensive first baseman. Admittedly, not a great hitter. Had some good years. Batted .296 one year with the Red Sox. Batted, like, .245 another year. So, definitely not a fantastic pick. But I think I'm just going to take a great skill and take him for first base. So, we'll go with George Scott.
Nice. Oh, boy. I think I'm going to do it, fellas. I've been looking for a left fielder, and a name crossed my mind, and I did a little bit of research. The only position in the outfield where you can be a lefty, really. I mean, well, you can do it in center. But most left-handed outfielders tend to go over to left field. Well, this fella was an outfielder in his younger days. And it just so happened that was with the Red Sox between the years of 1914.
He was going to be my cult hero. Dang.
Are you actually doing
it? No way.
Are you actually doing
it? I'm going to take Babe Ruth.
He was a pitcher.
To play left field. And I think this is legitimate because this wasn't a guy with a ton of mobility, as you can see in some of those videos. So, you know, I think it's safe to put him in the smallest part of the outfield. You can't deny the bat that this kid had and the potential that he showed with the Red Sox. He was here from age 19 to 24 before being shipped down to New York. But again, something we don't tend to talk about. But even in Boston, he had a very solid career. He hit .315, .325, .300, .322 in four of his 6 years here. So controversial, perhaps, but you can't deny it's pretty great to have a name like Babe Ruth in your team. So,
I'm intrigued by that because if we're going by only the Red Sox career, he really didn't do that much. I mean, his last year with the Red Sox, he had 29 home runs, 113 RBI.
Dead but ball otherwise, era, right?
What?
It was hard to hit homers back in those days. Also, remember, this was before the Green Monster was built. So he may have some defensive issues, actually, I realize.
I'm just surprised he wouldn't have picked him as a pitcher.
He also only played.
Totally brushes aside Ethan's point.
The pitcher thing? He didn't pitch while he was here, did he?
Oh, yeah. He was more known as a pitcher than a hitter.
In Boston.
Yeah, career ERA of 3. He started 40 games in 1916. 9 shutouts that year too. Pitched over 300 innings twice for the Red Sox.
Well, if we need a position player to come in and throw, we know who's going to do it.
Okay.
Austin Romine-esque, except for he's not going to give up a dinger to Brock Holt.
For the cycle.
Yes. Maybe not the last time we hear the name Brock Holt on this podcast.
I think he's a lock for one of your bench or cult hero picks.
We'll see. Babe Ruth in left field. I like it. Bring the controversy.
Is it me here?
Yep.
Yes, sir.
All right. So what do I still need? I obviously need second.
I need a manager. Manager, bench, cult hero.
Okay. We're going to rip the Band-Aid off for second base. We're going to go Marty Barrett. I don't know a whole lot about him. He was never a crazy home run hitter, but from the stats I'm looking at, he was a solid contact hitter, usually high 200s for batting average. And again, I have no idea what any of these defensive stats mean. But I'm looking at this MLB.com article. He was an honorable mention, but some of these guys up here I've just honestly never heard of before, and they barely spent any time with the Red Sox. But in his description, they said he was a rock at second base for the Sox in the mid-80s and was the MVP of the 86 ALCS, hitting .367. He was even better in the World Series against the Mets, hitting .433 with a 1.014 OPS.
Wow.
Which is a crazy high OPS for a series.
Wow.
But probably would have been World Series MVP from those numbers if it weren't for Bill Buckner. We ripped the Band-Aid off with second base. I think we're going to go manager. I could get the bench going here. This is interesting. I don't know who to go.
He's in a pickle.
Baseball puns. I love it. We're going to go manager here, and we're going to take Alex Cora.
I like it.
Just 324 games, 192 wins in a World Series. Screw job for this year. I have a hunch he'll be back. That's just a personal hunch he'll be back. And even excited to see what else he'll do. But so far, definitely up there as far as, like, I guess, output in his little time.
Yeah, I think...
terrible wording, but you get the point.
No, and that's another guy. Like, if he does come back, like you believe, and a lot of people around the Red Sox believe, he could be another guy who in 15 years we say, wow, that's an all-time head coach there.
Absolutely.
So, we'll see. Pretty straightforward one for me here. I'm going to go relief pitcher by the name of Bob Stanley. 12 years with the Red Sox, 552 relief appearances, the most among all Red Sox all time. And as MLB.com describes in the article that I am citing, he could kind of do it all. He could come in and go, you know, a long ways in the middle innings, or he could go late, get the save. He could do it all. Nicknamed the Steamer, gotta love that. And just a guy who always out there, always, you know, you like having the ball in his hand. Bob Stanley.
I like that. I was looking at him. He was up there on my list. I'm sure we looked at the same list. Good pick.
Yep.
My lineup's filled, right, as far as my starters?
Oh, boy. From what I can tell, yes. Yeah, okay. You're good.
So we'll head off to the bench right now. This is probably kind of a lazy pick, but – and I don't even really like this player that much, but I feel like he actually honestly went kind of under the radar last year. He's only spent 2 years with the Red Sox, but he has raked in those 2 years. I feel like I'm missing some power in my lineup. I've gone a lot for kind of fielding and consistency, but if I were to just put in if I need a pinch hitter to just get me a grand slam with the bases loaded, I'm taking JD Martinez.
Oh,
that's a good pick.
It's a really good pick.
And he has hit 43 and 36 home runs in his 2 years, cleared 100 RBI in both, cleared 300 batting average in both. Like, there's not too much more you could ask for. So, going with him. Manager's kind of weird. I want a manager that, one, wins games, and two, is from my era, which is largely old people. Am I right?
Yeah.
Probably not going to get anyone with a World Series.
Actually, I think I'm going to get someone with a World Series.
Player managers in, like, 1912.
Yes, Jimmy Collins. In the Hall of Famer, was a manager for only 6 years, but won almost 500 games in those 6 years. Including, they don't have the ring count up here, but I'm pretty sure he won a couple rings in that time span. Is a Hall of Famer, too. And originally, that's what I was thinking, is I want a manager that wins a ring, but you took Francona, you took Cora. I was not going to take John Farrell, and so that really limited my options, and so I'll take this guy. Seems pretty cool.
Yeah, he's one of those names, like, it's like folklore in the Red Sox, you know, way back there. Jimmy Collins. I like it.
Born in 1870. We're getting way back there.
Wow.
What was the 1876? That was like the confirmed Reconstruction end or something. Patrick, do you know history?
18 what?
1876. Was that like the marked end of Reconstruction or something?
That sounds right. I'd have to look it up. I don't know off the top of my head.
So this guy was a child before the end of Reconstruction. Pretty cool.
That is cool.
And he's managing J.D. Martinez.
Yes. J.D.'s going to be asking him to get out in the outfield, take some fly balls. Okay, my bench player, also a potential cult hero here, but I have rationale to make him my bench hero, and I have a guy, or my bench player, and I have a guy that I want to make my cult hero in a second. So it's going to work out. Bench player, as Patrick already said, it's going to be Brock Holt. You know, a guy that can do it all. We've talked on several occasions about his versatility and his importance to the team. I even went so far as to say that he was a more significant loss for the Red Sox than Mookie Betts. I still can sometimes, you know, find a way to put my brain in enough of a pretzel to believe that. But we're not going to try to do that now. I'm just going to say Brock Holt brings a lot of value in a lot of different spots. And if you need, you know, to give somebody a breakout in the field, he can go pretty much anywhere. If you need an intelligent runner to come in, if you need someone to do a job at the plate, he's got you. He's got all the boxes checked off. So Brock Holt, my bench player. Also, great locker room guy. I don't know if I have that many of those. So,
yeah. Interesting. All right. So bench player. I'll do cult hero. I don't think I have to explain it as much. Cult hero, we're going to go Tim Wakefield. I think he has to be here somewhere. Just for the longevity with the Red Sox, the two World Series. He did have the Aaron Boone home run in 2003, but still had plenty of success with the Red Sox beyond that. And then you just talk about the knuckleball and kind of just like the lore that we heard about him as like little kids, because he's like the only guy around that can throw a knuckleball. I'm just being amazed by that. And just a classic Red Sox 2000s guy.
We all tried to throw knuckleballs at some point.
Yeah, absolutely. Bench player, Tony Conigliaro. I said that right. Revere kid, classic North Shore kid. But didn't have a lengthy major league career. But, I mean, man, he made the most of it. He had like 24 home runs as a 19-year-old, 32, 28, 20, 20, and 36. In his time with the Red Sox, and then he came back briefly sometime down the road. But I mean, just as quickly as he was here, man, he put up some real numbers. I mean, 20 home runs in just 95 games in 1967. And again, I'm not going to even attempt to try and look at the defensive stats, but I hear about him enough. Maybe it's because he's a North Shore kid, but I mean, the offense is there. And I've heard about him plenty. So Tony Conigliaro off the bench. He's right field, left field, by the way.
You know the story with Tony C and why he didn't have that long of a career, right?
Well, didn't he correct me if I'm wrong, he had cancer.
He might have, but he wore a pitch right in the eyeball. And
oh, that's it. That's it.
He couldn't see anymore.
Yeah, that's right. That's it. I don't know why. I don't know why I thought cancer for.
Well,
he did die pretty young, 45. So maybe that was it.
Yeah. Well, there are cancer connections for my cult hero. So you're a little bit ahead there. And that's a terrible transition. But I'm going to take Jerry Remy as my cult.
It wasn't even cancer. I was so wrong. That's all right, okay. Never mind. I had thought of Remy earlier, so maybe I just had that on the mind.
Yeah, I was tempted to make Jerry Remy my bench player, and then Brock Holt the cult hero. But I decided to go this way because I don't know if Remy offers all that much in the field. He was okay second baseman, and he was kind of a contact hitter with a lot of speed, stole a lot of bases. A limited career with the Red Sox. His biggest contributions have definitely come beyond his playing career, but just a staple of the Red Sox community, and a guy that I think one of the most beloved, pretty much like Red Sox alumni figures in the history of the team. So I like having Jerry Remy on board. My final pick.
Well, I was looking at his stats. I love Jerry Remy. Did you know that his rookie year he led the league in times caught stealing?
Oh no!
For the California Angels, he got caught stealing 21 times.
Oh no, Jerry!
Yeesh!
But otherwise,
how many stolen bases did he have though?
He had 34. That's a lot. Not a great success rate, but had a career high of 41 for the Angels. All right, we know who I'm going to pick. I just want to shout out the other two guys I was considering: Jackie Bradley Jr.
I thought about him for my bench.
Yeah. I like just we've talked.
You're about just him so much. Wrong, Brady. Like
we'll talk about him in the future.
I just
the sports radio divil has just been in your head for so long.
No,
I mean Mascot is first hole in one, but other than that, I mean, not many things bouncing his way in the take machine.
Yeah. What does he offer aside from a couple web gems a year?
That was a pretty good zinger, I must say. I mean. Probably wouldn't ever say that to anyone's face, but
yeah. I hope we get a lot of viewers on this episode.
Get the zinging.
So Jackie Bradley Jr., one of the more overshadowed Red Sox, I think, because he only was on the team, I think, for 2 years, but I really liked him when he was on the Red Sox. Jason Bay, another guy I was considering.
That's a good pick.
He mashed, but.
Yeah,
he mashed 36 home runs, 119 RBI in 1 year. I mean, I'm going to take Daisuke. Daisuke is my pick, but shout out to Jason Bay.
Talk about guys who were here for a short amount of time but just raked. Adrian Beltre.
Yeah.
Man, imagine if he was here longer than a year. Hmm. I was at a game. He had a grand slam and a home run. It was crazy.
A lot of those guys, like Shane Victorino, a resurgence here.
Victor Martinez would have been a decent pick for catcher.
Yeah.
Or bench, even.
There are a lot of those guys, especially recently. But you like Daisuke, Ethan.
Yeah, I like Daisuke. He's just such a unique player. He had two really fantastic years and then a bad year, but I don't know. I always thought he was cool. Different, like, unlike a lot of players that you're ever going to see play, and a fun guy to root for. First Red Sox jersey that I had was Matsuzaka, so yeah, I'll go with Daisuke.
Nice.
Another good cult hero, like right around the same time as Daisuke, Hideki Okajima.
Mm-hmm. Okajima, yeah.
Okie
yeah.
Doki. His walkout song being Okie Doki, that was awesome.
Alrighty. Well, this concludes the draft. Here's the list we got going on.
Really like my team.
Yeah, we should put together some batting orders before we, you know, tweet out a couple graphics. I like the look of my team quite a bit. I'm pretty heavy on the early 2000s, but you know, those were some golden years, especially in our lifetime. So
I think I got a pretty good mix.
Yeah, you guys didn't feel good coming in, but what are the reactions now?
I think I have the most power out of any lineup here.
Dangerous.
Dangerous anywhere you look.
I would look forward to seeing how you put together like, this batting order.
Tony Conigliaro's on the bench, and he's arguably could be like my cleanup hitter.
Who's going to lead off?
I think I'm going to go Mookie.
Oh, my gosh. That is pretty dangerous.
I mean, that's where he did his best work.
Man.
I think I have a pretty natural, you know, Damon Nomar Ortiz Fisk right up the, you know, right at the start. I'll have to do some sorting out towards the bottom.
Maybe Williams. Nah, I think I'll go Williams third, Manny fourth.
Hmm.
Bogart's fifth.
Yeah, you got to put Williams third.
Yeah, Bogart's fifth.
Huh. Ethan, what do you think?
Ooh, I didn't even consider Mo Vaughn. He freaking raked, so I got to figure out him.
Man, yeah, you guys have a lot more like, power. Mine's.
So, I mean, like. Zoom's getting to everybody. I mean, I got like Veritek, like, even had decent power. And like, I read off like Trout Nixon, like, also decent power. These guys are just going to get buried in the lineup because of their, colleagues.
Yeah. Sheesh. Yeah, mine, I don't have as much power. I have a lot of consistent hitters. I mean, I'll have like Jim Rice, Wade Boggs, Yaz are probably like my 2, 3, 4. I'll probably have Pedroia lead off.
Yeah.
That's good. But my bottom of the order is going to be terrible because JD's coming off the bench. I think on the other side, I feel really good about my fielding. I love my pitchers that I got. It's just going to be, can we match it with some runs?
Right. I think you're going to be kind of a death by a thousand paper cuts team, you know, just slapping it around, manufacturing runs. Patrick's just going for the long ball, obviously.
Yep.
Yeah. Any major snubs? You talked about some of the short-term successes here. I think Victor Martinez had a chance. At the third catcher there.
Yeah.
But, I mean, those weren't pretty years for the Red Sox, so kind of forgettable. A lot of pitchers, too, I feel like we maybe missed out.
Yeah, I feel like Chris Sale definitely could have made it. Mm-hmm.
Well, if we had three starters, it'd probably be like Sale, Louis Tiant.
Yeah, Eckersley. Yeah.
There are a lot of – yeah. I mean, you forget how deep the Red Sox pitching history is. Like, there's so much there.
Yeah. I mean
Salto Amaki even had a case.
Do we have one starter that wasn't from 2000 or later?
I don't think so.
Oh no, we have Clemens and Cy Young, they're both on Ethan's team.
I mean like another like I mean
yep.
I don't know if he's necessarily snubbed like Koji, Derek Lowe, like him and like Keith Falk are like both those like cult hero pitchers of 2004.
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, we will put together some graphics on those. Tweet them out on our Twitter, at Duckboat Report. And any people can let us know what you think
of Coco Crisp. We forgot about Coco Crisp.
That's a cult hero.
Hanley?
Never made a cereal. I'm just playing in that.
I know. That would have killed.
Would have been great. So, but yeah, we'll have some Twitter content about this draft, and we look forward to hearing everybody's thoughts on it over there. On Twitter and on YouTube, of course, Brady GTV. That's where it's uploaded every single week. Any final thoughts before we say goodbye, fellas?
I gotta get to bed because I have a 7:20 tea time. Yeah, 7:20 tea time.
Where?
And it's currently 11 o'clock. Gannon Golf Course in Lynn, which is
11 o'clock.
5 minutes from my house, so it's not that much of an issue. But I still gotta get up and get up and shower. But
I gotcha.
So that's like a 6 a.m. wake up.
Well, fun times ahead.
I mean, it's one thing to wake up that early and get paid to carry your own bag, or get paid to carry someone else's bag when you're a caddy, but that's neither here nor there. I'll let you wrap up.
The show has gone full circle.
A lot of strays from Patrick Donnelly tonight. Wow.
I don't know. I've gone on tangents. I'm tired. I'm sorry.
That's all right. This is always a fun time to do a podcast because we get all the true emotions coming out.
Yeah.
I mean, we have some of the best banter with these all-time drafts.
All-time
drafts. I love them.
Yes.
I love like the all-time drafts.
I love the banter. Bring back Bean. We should just have a segment, Beantown Banter.
I mean, that's what it is.
That would really be full circle.
The Duck Boat Report, description, Bean Town Banter. That's basically what it is. Yep. Fun to do some baseball talk here, because most of the baseball talk has been negative the last few weeks, so it's nice to have some positive stuff, I guess, or at least going down memory lane a little bit.
It's probably the closest we're going to get to baseball this year.
Final bit of shade there from Patrick as he sign off. All right, that'll do it for tonight. We hope you guys enjoyed watching and listening to this all-time draft. Like we mentioned earlier, we'll hope to have a Patriots draft out at some point in the near future as well. Of course, you should go back and check out our other all-time drafts with the Celtics, featuring the three of us. Ethan's expertise definitely coming in handy there. And then we had Connor Ryan of Boston Sports Journal on to do a Bruins draft with Patrick and
I. Bruins one was great.
It was pretty good. I was a little bit outclassed, I must say, but it was a lot of fun. Look forward to the Patriots one. We'll see who has the last laugh maybe in that. But for now, hope you guys enjoyed this Red Sox draft, and we will see you next time.